You are our chiefest joy, Master. We give you praise. We thank you for who you are. Just take a moment and just talk to your Lord. Talk to your daddy. Just talk to him. Maybe you came here with a burden this morning. His love will not fail you. He is here. He is here. May I kneel every morning. Kneel every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy. See his face. See him in your heart. They are new every morning. They are new every morning. New every morning. Great is thy goodness. Time, let's sing it with your heart, with your lips, with revelation. They are new.
They are new every morning.
New every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Sing it one more time. They are new every morning.
Every morning.
Great is thy faithfulness. Jesus still thrill your heart? Does he still thrill your heart? Does Jesus still excite you? There is no one like him. There is no one that can compare to him. When we're going through tough times in life, we can just look to him and we know that he will never leave us nor forsake us. And sometimes when I'm ministering up here, the Holy Spirit begins to show me some of the struggles that people go through. You're not alone. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He said, lo, I'm with you always. Hope those words will encourage somebody today. He is here. He is here. You don't have to wait. You don't have to worry. He is here. He is here. Right now. He is here. He is here. He is here right now. He is here. To meet every need, to meet every need. That's why we praise. That's why we pray. We pray. We pray. Jesus loves me, Jesus loves me, Jesus loves me, and I am so glad that Jesus loves me, Jesus loves me, but let's sing it one more time. I am so glad that Jesus loves me, Jesus loves me, I am so glad. God, you are so good. God, you are so good. God, you are so good. You are so good to sing it one more time. God, you are so good. Oh, you are so good. Believe that he's good to you. Let's clap our hands and give him praise. Just say hello to somebody. You've ever seen it. I'll just talk to you a little bit today. Amen. Hug somebody next to you. Amen. Amen. What a joy. What a joy. What a joy. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Are you excited this morning? Praise God. You beautiful people. Kingdom Embassy International. I want to welcome you. I want you to know that you are precious. Say, I am precious. Say, I am precious. You know, one of the things we have to learn is listen to a friendly voice. Amen. It's good to see you. Amen. Learn to listen to a friendly voice. How many of you actually listened to the teaching yesterday? Anyone was in line? You listened to it? You need to get on and listen to it. It's talking about developing, understanding timing. Amen. Understanding timing. Go online, check it out. It will help you. We've had over 2,000 people that have listened to it. Can I have a big amen? Now, it is important that you get there and listen to it. But today, I have something good to tell you. Jesus is here. I say, Jesus is here. You are amazing people. You are the object of love. Say, I am the object of love. Say, I am the object of love. Amen. Now, all around the world today, people are celebrating what they call Palm Sunday. Isn't that correct? Am I right? Now, I mean, what does that mean? To some of us, we don't know what it means. Sometimes it's important we get a bit of the historical significance of what happened. We have a Jesus that is not dead, he's alive. Can I have a big amen? So, but this week is considered the Passion Week. If you're Catholic or if you're in a lot of other Christian body around the world today, we are celebrating what are called Palm Sunday. And I want to take you to get a little bit of study of what actually happened when Jesus came. Hallelujah. Amen. And we are going to be reading a passage of scripture. We're going to be reading from Matthew chapter 21. If you have your Bibles, turn with me there. And it is found, this is one of the stories that's found in all four of the Gospels. There's one story, and we will try to kind of put like a composite or a layering of the different aspects of it to understand the importance why Jesus came. You see, a lot of times things that happen in Christianity, some things are not understood. But we'll bring a little understanding about that today. Is that okay? And this was actually towards the ending, towards the concluding days of Jesus Christ's ministry on earth. And they had come to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. How many of you know what a Passover is about? And now, just to give you a little bit of history, it's when the children of Israel were in captivity back in Egypt. When they were in captivity, and then God began to do some incredible things to show Pharaoh that he was the God of the children of Israel. So he began to do some things, and one of the things he did was when the death angel passed over them. In other words, the Jews came to celebrate when death passed over them. Can somebody say amen? When the angel of death passed over them, the Bible says back in the Old Testament, it says, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Everybody say amen. Tell the neighbor there is a bloodline. Say there's a bloodline. Said when the enemy comes and it sees the bloodline, he will avoid you. See, when you understand the power of what was about to take place, then it makes a lot of sense to bring that to remembrance. The Bible says that God told Moses, it said, you will take a lamb. Every family will take one lamb, and they will sacrifice that lamb. And what they will do is they would take the lamb's blood and put it over the doorpost. Over the doorpost. Why was that? You know, they put that over the doorpost so that when death came and saw the blood. Why is it? Most times when death occurs, blood comes out. How many of you understand that? So it's marking that person has already died. You can't kill somebody twice. Are you hearing me? Oh, are you ready for this today? Are you ready for this today? Now, because when the death angel comes and sees the sign of death, sees the blood, it will pass over to another person that is not yet dead. That's why the Bible says you are crucified with Christ. So when death comes towards you, it sees the blood of Jesus, it avoids you. Let me tell you, when a bullet is coming your way, if it sees the blood, it will change its direction. I believe in the supernatural. I believe in miracles. How many of you can say you believe in miracles? Say, I believe in miracles. Say, I believe in miracles. See, let me tell you, I believe in the God that can turn the clock backwards. If you don't believe that, you don't believe this book. I believe in the God that can make the sun go backwards. I believe in the God that can part the Red Sea. It's not just a story, it's reality. Are you hearing me? I believe in the God that raises the dead. Are you hearing me? No, there are Christians today that sounds like stories. No, those are not stories. Those are realities. Are you with me? God can turn your situation in a microsecond if you can trust him. It doesn't matter how long it's been. It doesn't matter how many people are against you. If God is on your side, you can't lose. That's the God I'm talking about today. Are you hearing me? But today in Christianity, what we do sometimes is we have just become like a social club. We come to church It's an indictment against this generation. We come to church and people just want to do their Sunday activities and never make contact with the living Christ. You cannot make contact with the living Christ and go home the same. Are you hearing me? When you make contact with Jesus, something's got to give. The old life must die. And then the new will come. Can somebody say amen? Can somebody say amen? When you come to Jesus, deliverance is guaranteed. Healing is assured. Prosperity is available. So when they come, when the dead angel will come, and he will come, and he will see the blood, he will pass over them, and then go to the Egyptians' houses. But the thing is, if you're a Jew, and you don't apply the blood, death will come to your house too. You have to apply the blood to your own house. Can somebody say amen? Now, there were two things about that. The Passover was this. They had to have a Passover feast. So the lamb's body was roasted over a flame. Can somebody say amen? When you roast it over a flame, it leaves stripes on it. Those stripes was for healing. How many of you understand that now? So if you put something, if you roast something over a grill or something, you see like those stripes wherever the meat is being held. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? Now, the lamb's body was to be eaten and then the blood was to be applied. So let's bring it forward now so that you understand why Jesus was coming. Most people did not even know why he was coming. So they're celebrating Passover, and the Passover lamb was coming to them. Are you hearing me? So they were going to Jerusalem to the feast of the Passover. So they had, back in Egypt, they had a lamb. They had each a lamb in the house. A lamb was provided for each house. So a house would take the lamb, kill it. The family would take a lamb and kill it, and then put the blood on the doorpost, and then eat the body. And this is what happened. When the death angel saw the blood, it passed over them. But when they ate the lamb's body, everybody said the body. Say the body. When they ate the body, they had strength to last them for 40 years. Are you hearing me? Because the Bible says that they left Egypt with silver and gold, and there was not one sick person amongst them. Can you imagine that the children of Israel did not die because of sickness in the wilderness? They died because of disobedience. For 40 years, not one sick person in the whole country. Think about that in the United States. Are you hearing me? Everybody said the power of the blood. Say the power of the lamb. Now, here is the setup. People are doing, they are doing their ceremonies. Are you with me? They are doing their, what they call ceremonies. Let's go to Jerusalem. This is hundreds of years after this happened. Hundreds and hundreds of years after this happened. And here they were, everybody's coming to do what they call rituals. For example, we're here on Sunday. People come to church to do ritual. But do you know while you're here, you can encounter heaven for real? Today. So they all came to Jerusalem. Everyone comes and says, okay, let's go and do the Passover feast. And what will happen? They will have the Seder bread and all those things. They have all the food they will eat and everything to remember. And while they were doing all of this, the real lamb had come to them. See, we can be busy doing ceremonies and miss Jesus when he walks in. May that not be our life. May our life be that recognizes Jesus at every moment. Can somebody say amen? Can somebody say amen? And here they were. They were waiting. They've heard about the Messiah that's coming. That would redeem them. Remember, they were in Egypt. And there were slaves under the Egyptians. And hundreds of years later, they were slaves to the Romans. So they were waiting for a Messiah to come that would redeem them. In the Old Testament, a lamb was slain. Are you hearing me? When the lamb was slain, the lamb became the sacrifice that opened the door for them to walk out. And God was sending another lamb. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? So much that when he came, he was amongst them, and a man called John the Baptist says, "Behold the Lamb of God." Now he's announced as the Lamb of God. And people missed it. Isn't that interesting? Jesus said to the Jews, he said, are you paying attention to this? He said to the Jews, he says, "Abraham, before Abraham was, I am. Abraham saw my day and was glad." Everybody say, he was glad. Now, what did Abraham see? What happened was when God told Abraham, "Take your only son Isaac," and he said, God had to emphasize only son, because God was trying to reveal to Abraham what he, God, was going to do. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Can somebody say amen? So he had to reveal that to Abraham and said, "Abraham, take your son that you love, your only son, and sacrifice him." So Abraham was obedient to God and took his son, laid him up there, and guess what happened? As he was about to kill him, the son asked the question, said, "Father, we have the wood, we have everything, but where is the lamb? Where is the lamb?" Because they were looking for the substitute. Now, this was before the children of Israel were under bondage. Are you hearing me now? Everybody say, "It takes the lamb." Say, "It takes the lamb." Now, I'm trying to get you to understand how God foreshadowed what was going to happen and people still missed it. And how that continues today, that a sacrifice has been made available, we can still apply the blood. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? Death can pass over your family today. I said death can pass over your family today. What happened? Abraham, the Bible says that Abraham, he tied up a son and he was about to kill him. And at that moment, he said, when the son said, "Where is the lamb?" And he turned, God shook something in the corner there, and he saw a ram cut in the thicket. That right there, it was cut in there by its horns. And he says, "I see the lamb." He saw that lamb was the substitute for his son. How many of you understand that? Everybody says substitution. Now, God's plan, why did God have to have that kind of plan? God had a plan to restore us back to his dreams. But it requires a sacrifice. Everybody say it takes a sacrifice. Now, I'm trying to get you along to see what was happening when Jesus came. All of those things actually were already prophesied or already occurred. And Jesus, when he came, he said, "Abraham saw my day." Why? Because it says, "I see the lamb." In other words, Abraham was saying, "I see God has provided a substitute for us." How many of you understand that? See, if God has provided a substitute, why do you have to die? Why do you have to be sick? Somebody took your sickness. Somebody took your pain. Somebody took your sins to make you free. God has provided. Tell a neighbor, God has provided. Say, God has provided. So what we are looking for, there's a provision made. If you leave this place today, you can leave with one thing, knowing God has already provided what I need. He's already provided. Tell a neighbor, he's already provided. What we are looking for, God has already. Do you know that before you had a need, God knew you were going to have it? Before you needed a savior, he died for you. Before you needed a healer, he said, "I am your healer." God is aware of what you need before you have a need of it. God knows you're going to need a house before you're even homeless. Am I talking to somebody here today? God knows that maybe you have some needs. He knows those needs. The Bible says your heavenly Father knows those things. But first, seek his kingdom. The things you're looking for, he adds it for free. Can I have a big amen? Can I have a big amen? Now, why am I setting this up so that you understand when I start talking about the rest of the story, everything will make sense. Because some people don't have all this knowledge. So I'm trying to put it together to understand the significance of Jesus coming. Now here was Jesus. He said, Abraham saw my day and was glad. Then here comes Jesus again. John the Baptist says, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. He announced it, and God confirmed it. And then what happened? For 3 years, Jesus demonstrated. When the Holy Ghost came upon him, he demonstrated what it means to be a son of God. He demonstrated what it means to be sent from God. Miracles were happening. Debt were raised, all kinds of things. Miracles of finances. And somebody said to me, well, I don't believe in miracles of finances. I said, then you don't believe in five loaves of bread and two fishes. You can feed 5,000 men. Then you don't believe your Bible and you call yourself a preacher. And there were 12 baskets left over. That's called overflow. Can I have a big amen? If you don't, I heard some scholars many years ago say, well, you know, those were big, big, giant bread. The young man that had the bread must have been a giant. The fishes were whales. You know how people try to make up stupid stories? No, we serve the God of miracles. Can somebody say amen? I mean, I've heard some people say, you know, the Egyptians, you know, the water that drowned them, you know, the Red Sea, you know, there was really water there. No, the Bible says dry ground. It meant dry ground. Can somebody say amen? When the Bible says dry ground, that meant they didn't have mud on their toes. It was dry. The walls of water was each side. Can I have a big amen? When God says something, the problem is when people are not experiencing it, they reduce it to their experience. If you're not experiencing it, raise your experience to meet God's word. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? If you're not living right, raise your experience to live right by the word of God. Can somebody say amen? Tell a neighbor the word works. Say the word works. Say it is working. Don't use your experience as the measuring yardstick for your success. Use the word of God all the time. The scholars were saying, they were arguing, they said, well, you know, the Egyptians, you know, no, they there was water there, and, you know, the children of Israel went through a bit of water, you know, they tried to make out all kinds of stories. You see, the water wasn't really deep. Sometimes a wave would move back, and then the water would be ankle deep. That's when they passed through. And my thought is, if it's ankle deep, horses drowned. That's more of a miracle. To drown a horse in ankle deep water. Stupidity, right? What am I trying to get across to you? God still does miracles today. If you believe that, say amen. Let's get away from our daily experiences and make God's experience our daily experiences. Miracles are happening. Tell the neighbor, miracles are happening. Because you've been through something doesn't mean miracles stop happening. Because a neighbor died doesn't mean God stopped raising the dead. Can I have a big amen? Let's go for God's best. Can somebody say amen? Now, why am I saying this to you? Hear this now. Jesus, here he was. Let's look at the scripture I started with. Matthew 21, is that what I said, right? Verse 1. I want you to pay attention to what the progression of what happened. And when they drew near unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethpage, unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus, saying unto them, go into the village over against you, and straightway you shall find an ass tied, which is a donkey, same word for a donkey, and a colt with her, loose them. Everybody say, loose them. Say, loose them. Now, you're going to learn some principles today that there are certain things that you're moving. Some of you are about to move to your inheritance now. Can you imagine this? Jesus said, go to this city, go to this place, you'll find a donkey and a colt, which is basically a young donkey. Two of them, he said, go and lose them. Everybody say lose them. Say lose them. In other words, say untie them and bring them to me. Can you imagine? It wasn't prearranged. How did Jesus see that there were there was two animals there, a donkey and the colt. Some of you are about to have your eyes open to your inheritance. Can somebody say amen? Can somebody say amen? Tell the neighbor there are donkeys everywhere. They are waiting for you to locate them. Let me tell you something. Do you know that in this city, there are people that have what you've been looking for? You believe that? The money you're looking for, there's somebody holding it. May God open your eyes to see that. Some of us have been struggling. Here's Jesus. He said, go to this place. And when we go there, go to this city, you will find a donkey tied with a colt. Untie them and bring them to me. Everybody say, it's time to untie. Say, it's time to untie. Now you understand what's going on here. Let's keep reading the scripture. I want to show you something because you're wondering where he's going with this. There is more to his coming than just, oh, let's get the palm and be waving it. There were certain things I was doing. I don't want to be part of the crowd. I don't want to be just his disciples. I want to be in him to see how he operates. And if any man say unto you, you shall say the Lord has need of you, of them. Can you imagine the audacity? Somebody, okay, today, a donkey. It's a beast of burden back then. Today, we don't have donkeys, we have cars. Everybody say update. Update. Say update. Can you imagine Jesus is about to come to a city or you're about to enter a city. You come to a city and you said, go to Boston, to this street. You find a Mercedes-Benz there, brand new. Just go in there and just get the key and bring it to me. If anybody asks, you tell them that the Lord has need of it. Now, it doesn't make sense now when I say Boston. First thing they will do is, most people will say, oh, are they going to call the cops on you? Am I right? Now, when you're reading Bible stories, it's, oh, Bible. Now, when we update it, think about it happening right down here. Providence. Can you imagine God shows you something? Everybody says it's time to see the invisible so that I can do the impossible. How many of you got that now? See, God wants to open our eyes to things. Jesus said, go to this place, you'll find a donkey and a colt tied up. Untie them and bring them to us. In fact, in Luke Gospel, it talked about, he said, and when the people, so he didn't talk about one owner, there were several people that owned those animals. It's interesting. Because when you're reading it, you think it's one man, and just say, okay, one man is easy to make a decision. No, but when there are more people owning one property, they have to come to a decision, all of them. How many of you can say amen to that? See, now Luke now gives us a different picture. He said there were like a committee. Let me tell you something. It doesn't matter whether there's one person that owns it or 10 people that own it. When it's time to untie it, they'll all agree. Come on, I talked to somebody here. When it's time to untie what God has made available to you, they will all come to agreement just for you. Can you imagine? Are you hearing me? In Luke Gospel, he said, and if the people that owned it, plural, there were more than one person that owned it. So he said, if the people that owned it ask of you, tell them. He didn't say ask them. May God shift your thinking today. Sometimes you need to tell people. Let me tell you something. God can put something in your spirit. You know something. You tell them, listen, you do this. They would not argue. They would know it's God. You do that today, people will think, oh, you preacher, are you trying to take people's cars? No. Am I right? If Jesus did that today and said, go to downtown Providence, you see a brand new Mercedes and you see an SUV, just take both of them and come to me. Ah, scandal on TV. Preacher takes over property of people. Am I right? Today's media, come on. Now, let me tell you, the people that would accuse the preacher of doing it are other Christians. Why? They are jealous that the preacher has the audacity to pull what God has said. Am I telling the truth? Now, sometimes it's not those that you think will oppose you that opposes you. It's those close to your house. Sometimes your family members cannot understand why you chose to do what you're doing. Am I telling the truth? Sometimes those close to you, the problem is most of them are too close to see the you that God sees. They keep seeing you as a child, as their son, as their husband, as their wife, as their daughter. That's all they see. But can they look beyond who you are physically and see the Christ in you? Let them see Jesus in a person. Can somebody say amen? See, that's our problem today, because people look at you based on your mistakes. God looks at you and sees himself in you. Are you hearing me? People are looking and say, well, he did that. Oh, he did that. Yeah, they said the same thing about Jesus. They said the same thing about Peter. Oh, he denied Jesus, but he preached about denial. He was so free, he didn't even know what denial was. Get so free in Jesus, you don't know what your past mistakes were. Amen. Can I have a big amen? Amen? Can I have a big amen? And anybody that tries to remind you, tell them to back off. They're not from God. They're from the enemy. It's time to rise up and pursue God's dreams. Can somebody say amen? Because you're busy trying to defend yourself when you're supposed to be untying donkeys. Am I telling the truth? There are resources. Everyone say there are resources. Everywhere I look, it's time to untie them. Now, what am I telling you? When Jesus came there, he told them, he said, go and find this. You'll see a donkey and a colt. Bring both of them to me. When they ask you, just tell them that the Lord has need of it. Everybody say, it's time to get it back. And he says, and immediately he will send them. Hear this now. It said, now it is to happen that it might be fulfilled what was spoken through the prophet, saying, tell the daughters of Zion, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, meek and riding upon a donkey and upon a colt. Everybody say amen. Amen. Everybody say amen. Now, let me explain to you, and I've heard the religious people say, oh, Jesus is so humble, and he was riding a donkey. He was riding a donkey. He was so humble and so, he didn't have money. Let me tell you, the equivalent of what he did was, the Bible says he rode on a colt. That means a donkey that nobody has ever ridden on. It's like having a brand new car off the factory that nobody even entered. Are you hearing me now? Back then, they didn't have cars. And why did he come on a donkey? Why not on a horse? Can I tell you why? Do you want to know? Because they were expecting a king to come, but the way they expected the king to come was on a horse trying to restore them. But you see, when Jesus came, he wasn't coming as a king to do war. He was coming as a king of peace. That's why he used a donkey instead of a horse. A horse is used for war. A donkey is used for peace. How many of you understand that now? Can somebody say amen? Can somebody say amen? Because when the king came the first time, he came to win the people back. He came as a prince of peace. But when he comes back, he's coming as the glorious conqueror. Can somebody shout hallelujah? He defeated the enemy as a peacemaker. Oh, okay. I'll keep it right there. Are you hearing me? When Jesus defeated Satan, he defeated Satan as a peacemaker. Amen. But when he comes back as the victorious conqueror's king, then Satan, he knows his place. But hear what? Do you know now that he lives in you, he lives as the victorious king? Amen. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? Because the people, hear what the Bible says. Let's keep going. Meek and riding upon a donkey and upon a colt, the foal of a donkey. And the disciples went and did just as Jesus instructed them, and brought the donkey and the colt, and put on them their garments. Why? Because the disciples did not know whether Jesus was going to be on the donkey or on the colt. So those men were not spiritual. Are you hearing me? Those men were like us sometimes. They were just carnal, so they said, okay, two animals, let's dress them up. I don't know which one is going to use, but let's just dress both of them. And that's what the Bible says. And they put garments on them, and he sat thereon. Now, the fact is, he sat there. Did he sit on both of them at the same time? You can't ride two horses, except you have a chariot or something. Am I right? Is this helping you? Is this helping you? Because you'll understand, people will misunderstand you, and when they misunderstand you, they will misrepresent you. And when they misrepresent you, then they begin to oppose you. How about if you understand that? But when you know who you represent, if you know who you are, you will not have any issues with your identity, and you'll be clear about your purpose, and no matter the opposition, you just blow through it. Can somebody say amen? It's all about knowing who sent you. Are you with me? Are you with me? Let me tell you, there could be 7 billion people against you. If God is on your side, you win. One with God is majority. Are you hearing me? When God is on your side, you already won. Are you with me? Tell the neighbor, I cannot lose. Say, I cannot lose. And the Bible continues, and it says, and most of the crowd spread their garments in the road. They spread. Why did they spread their garments? Because now, remember this, I want you to pay attention. People's motives always show. Why? They took off their clothing and they're throwing it. Why? So it shows I am submitting to you. Now they thought, now there was a little confusion because of thinking, now the Messiah is coming. He's going to redeem us. He's going to fight the Romans. He's going to do this. But they didn't know he won the war already in a different way. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. If it were of this world, my servants will fight. See, there are certain things we don't fight about. One of it is, you don't fight a victory that's already won. Can I have a big amen? Can I have a big amen? I'm declaring to you today that your battles are over. The only fight you have to fight is to believe what God has said. See, that's the only fight between your earlobes. Yeah. Interlope warfare. That's it. Just to believe what God says. Let me tell you, you know, all those things about, oh, I'm going through this. Let me tell you, it all has to do with what you believe. Choose to believe the good news. It's time to hear some friendly voices. People that can tell you what God said. Not people that will come and justify their anger and bitterness and tell you what God didn't say. Are you hearing me? Choose wisely who you listen to. Because they will influence you to something else God didn't say. You better listen to people that know the heart of God. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? It's not about somebody quoting the scriptures. It's about somebody catching the spirit of the word. Can I have a big amen? Because I can quote scriptures that will condemn you. I mean, if you know that, how many of you like meat here? You like to eat meat. I didn't say like meat like you have to buy it and make a bed out of it. No, I'm saying, how many of you like to eat meat? Wave at me. But I can use a scripture like this. It's a meat for the belly and belly for meat, both shall perish. And you stop eating meat. Yeah, I tried that in New York and somebody almost fell for it. I started laughing. I said, boy, know the scriptures for yourself. Because somebody can take a verse of scripture and make it say what they want to say. But the thing is, Jesus said, you don't know what spirit you're of. You've got to know the spirit. When we come to people, I'm not opposing you. I'm not fighting against you. I am for you to manifest the fullness of God's inheritance in you. How about if you understand that now? I mean, if you understand that. So when I correct you, I'm not correcting you because I want to show I'm better than you. I'm correcting you because I can see something in you that's worth saving. Let's save it and go to the top. How many of you understand that? If that's not the right spirit, then you don't want to be part of it. Hear this. These people were spreading their garments on the road, and others cut branches from the palms, from the trees, and spread on the road. And the crowd that went before him, and they followed him crying out, saying, Hosanna! Hosanna! In fact, do you know what Hosanna means? Do you know what it means? You know what it means? It means save now. We are saved. Are you hearing me? They were in other words saying, our Savior has come. He indeed came. But they thought, they were thinking like politicians. No, these are not spirit. These are not the people in the temple. No, these were ordinary people that were tired of being under oppression. So it was a big revolution that took place. And the people were spreading their garment. Oh, our king has come. Our king has come. Our king has come. Hosanna in the highest. He has saved us now. To the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And we came into Jerusalem. The entire city was stirred up, saying, who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. Everybody say amen. Everybody say amen. It's amazing when he came in there. The whole city was shaken. And now remember, he was coming to the capital city. He was coming to the seat of power. He was coming to where a king will become. It's called the royal city of David. He was coming to Jerusalem. And when he came, they said, the son of the king has come. Now, if it's the son of the king, that makes him the king. I mean, if you understand that. So here is the reaction. One group is excited. The other group is concerned. So first order of duty, when he arrived, what did he do? After he arrived, they're celebrating him. He went to the temple. And what did he do? He started beating people up. I don't think they were ready for that. He went to the religious people first and put them straight. Can I have a big amen? If judgment starts, it starts in the house of God. You see, most people, I said last week when I was here, I couldn't speak because all I could see is how many broken lives out there in churches, and they've been condemned. Some of them want to commit suicide. Some of them are just feeling so guilt, and religious people are keeping them bound. Do you know that religion makes money out of your sins? They will give you enough forgiveness to keep you under lockdown. Am I telling the truth? They would give you enough forgiveness till next week. You come back for more forgiveness. They'll never tell you you're free indeed. How many of you understand that? So when Jesus came and instead of saying, whom the Son makes free is free indeed. Oh, religious people said, no, this is bad for business. You know, because let me explain to you how religion makes money out of people's mistakes. Hello? Are you ready to know? Let me tell you, this is how it used to work in the temple. Of course, you have the money changers, the traders outside. This is what goes on. This is what goes on. Are you ready to hear it? Are you ready to hear it? This is what happens. The traders will come and say, okay, the high priest will say, tomorrow when they come, we're going to tell them you have to give 3 turtle doves, you have to give 3 lambs. And so the people, knowing this ahead of time, will increase the price of whatever the priest will say. How many of you understand that? It was a cartel. How many of you understand that? They were making money out of sin. So the high priest will tell the traders outside, we are going to ask them to give maybe 3 chickens for their sins today, tomorrow when they come. So now the price of the chicken was $5. Tomorrow is 10. And that's what's required by law. You have to get the 3 chicken. How many of you understand that? So Jesus knew this. When he arrived, they're celebrating him. First thing he did was straighten them all out. He said, give on my father's house a den of thieves. You have made merchandise of the people. That's religion. Religion will never let you be free. They will keep you, they give you enough freedom to keep you in bondage. How many of you understand that? Today, break free from it in Jesus' name. Tell your neighbor, I have a choice. Say, I have a choice. See, let me tell you, no religious person has the power to dominate your spirit. Jesus is your Lord. And if it says you're forgiven, if it says your past is over, it is over. Now, let's put it all the way. If somebody hurt you, you forgive them. Don't hold on to it. What do? Release them and let God handle them. Amen. Can somebody say amen? But what am I saying? Get away from weights so that your focus becomes on purpose. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? In other words, here was Jesus, first order of business, whip everybody. I don't think they liked him after that. What happened? The week goes on, and why did the people come? Because they must have heard about the miracles. In fact, if you read in Luke, he had just raised Lazarus from the dead. So he was very popular. He was hot cake. Everybody wanted a piece of him. And he shows up. And can you imagine, 5 days later, the same crowd that were hoping he was their hero coming in, same people were saying, crucify him. Listen, don't pay attention to men's approval. Can I have a big amen? If you wait for men's approval, you'll be disappointed all the time. Because today they're your friends, tomorrow they're your worst enemies. Look to Jesus. He is the one that will never fail you. Are you hearing me? And when you find a friend that acts like Jesus, hold on to them. Can I have a big amen? Can I have a big amen? Why am I sharing this with you today? Because there are things that need to be unlocked in your life this week. Can I have a big amen? They are donkeys that God has ahead of you to untie. But for you to do that, number one, you've got to act with boldness. You can't, I mean, Jesus didn't tell them, well, go and search for a donkey. You go to this house, if this, you can't find it, go to the next one. No, he was very specific. He said, go to this place. May God open your eyes to see where things are tied up for you. Can somebody say, amen. Say, Lord, open my eyes that I may see. It's possible. Say, it's possible. One of the things I realized was this. Do you know that he came to fulfill prophecies? What he did was prophesied by Zacharias. In other words, do you know that you are here to fulfill prophecies? Oh, can I say it one more time? Can I say it one more time? See, most of us are waiting for a prophetic word from a prophet. You're going to do great things. No, read that book. It's full of prophecies about you. When a prophet comes to you, they only confirm what you already know. Can I have a big amen? That way, God has already put one picture in you of what you're supposed to do. All the big dreams and the great things God has spoken about you. The next thing he does is he uses me to shine a light on that. And then you get excited. It becomes a spark or a trigger in you to go and do it. If I start telling you and you have no picture of it, you get a little confused. Am I telling the truth? Am I telling the truth? In other words, God has already put things in his word concerning you. It's time to prophesy about those things and go and fulfill them. Somebody say amen. One thing I realize about Jesus, he was always about fulfilling the word. He will do this to fulfill. Can you imagine? He knew that the Bible had written about a colt and a donkey. How many hundreds of years have people been reading that? They've been reading the same passage. Behold, your king comes in a donkey and a colt. They've read that over and over. That's the same thing happening in the church world. We're reading scriptures after scriptures. When are we going to make that scripture come alive? Amen. We were in Germany, and this guy, he was from Bulgaria, and he was the Eastern Orthodox Church. And Jesse remembered, because as we were speaking, and they began to tell him some of the things we did, miracles and things. And the guy looked at me. He said, that's what we should be doing. He is from the Orthodox Church. He was mad that they don't see that. We don't see that anywhere. He was shaking. He started crying. He said, that's what I've been waiting all my life for. A young man. And all I can think about is, do you know that this book needs a body to wrap around it? This book needs a flesh to give it life. You are that flesh. I say you are that flesh. There are prophecies written about you. God has written big things about you. Believe it. Do you know that the scripture Jesus fulfilled, people have read it and nobody believed it? Isaiah says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor and all blah, 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 blah. Fine. They've been reading that for years, for centuries. They're reading it. Oh, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. One day, a man called Jesus shows up. And then they have three seats. He's the guest speaker. So they put him on the left. The host is on the right. And there's an empty seat in the middle for the Messiah that was coming. And here was the guest speaker. And they handed him a book from the prophet Isaiah. And he began to open. I'm thinking, didn't they tell him read here today? No. He began to open and found. Everybody said he found. In other words, begin to find the good stuff in the book. Are you catching this? Jesus found scriptures people have been reading for years, for centuries, and he found where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he went public with it. But this today, that day, it sounded differently. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Everyone's looking at him, are you nuts? Just read your thing. Because he has anointed me to announce good news to the poor. First message, prosperity. Can somebody say amen? Healing to the broken heart. Second message, healing. Third message, deliverance. And all the people that have a problem with this, I tell them, you're really not sent from Jesus. Because if you're sent from Jesus, you preach what he preached. Can I have a big amen? Now, this is what happened. Jesus finished preaching this. And he closed the book. He did something crazy. He closed the book and said, today, these scriptures you've heard is fulfilled in your hearing. In other words, Jesus is saying to them, today you don't have to read it anymore. You can see it live. That's the beginning of trouble. When you know and you're sure of who you are and you start making people know it, opposition stands up against you. But the problem is this. If you already know who you are, it's too late for them. Can I say that one more time? If you are too sure of yourself, the opposition cannot stop you. Am I talking to somebody here? Let me tell you something. No matter how hard things have been for you, today you're discovering you're more than who you think you are. The enemy thought he got you before. He has attacked your mind, put you all kinds through all kinds of things, but you just discovered you're more than a conqueror. And you just tell them, back off. And those that have been trying to tell you, see, your past is this, tell them, that's my past. This is a new me. You start speaking like this, the enemy hates people that are bold. Are you hearing me? They will call that arrogance. That's exactly what you call Jesus, for him to make statements like that. Who does he think he is? Today, the scripture is fulfilled. And the Bible says, and then he sat down. Oh, yeah, you already heard me say this. He did not sit in his seat that he sat before. He sat in the middle chair that was meant for the Messiah. Are you nuts? It's like the Pope's chair, and the Pope is not there. And the person that was the bishop that's presiding waiting for the Pope now goes and sits in the Pope's chair. In other words, saying, I am the Pope. That'll be third world war in the church. Are you hearing me? That, everybody say audacity. Say, I have the audacity of the scriptures. Can I have a big amen? When you know the word, you are audacious. See, people will try to, you know how people manipulate you? Well, brother, you know, we have to be very careful about this. You have to be very, just tell them, back off. You didn't save me, he did, and the one who saved me said so. See, the thing is, I'll tell you, but you don't want to receive counsel. I'll only receive counsel if you sound like the one who saved me. I'm not going to receive counsel from you sounding like the world. I receive counsel from those that sound like my Lord. If I come and start talking what Jesus didn't say, you not listen to me. You just look at me and like, something is wrong with you. You ought to sound like the book. You don't sound from your emotions. If I tell a brother, no, we know we all get sick. You say, oh, this is not what you told us before. You told us that he heals. Am I right? Because you're sick doesn't mean healing stopped. Can I have a big amen? What you do, you contend for it. You go after it. It's yours. Can I have a big amen? Say the audacity of the scriptures. The moment you have a clarity about the word of God, no enemy can stop you. See, they'll only stop you when you're not sure of yourself. How would they stop you? They will only suggest to you. Did you hear what I said? They will only suggest to you what you should do differently. Oh, brother, you know, if you do this, this is what's going to happen. If you do that, this is what's going to happen. Tell them, back off. If you can't give me the word, back off. Can I have a big amen? Don't tell me how many people said this. It's not a democracy. It's the king's word. If God says I'm healed, I believe that. If God says I'm prosperous, I believe that. Don't tell me, brother, you know all this prosperity gospel. Prosperity. Somebody tried to pull that stunt yesterday. How many of you remember that? Somebody wrote, oh, this prosperity gospel. He thought I was going to back off. I went after him. Please don't play with me. I'm not one of those people. I'm not one of those preachers. I'm the king's son. Can I have a big amen? If you come after me, I'm going to go after you. Why? I have the word on my side. By the time I was done, the guy just disappeared. See, let me tell you. How do you deal with a lie? Blinded with the truth. Can I have a big amen? Come blazing and the devil will disappear. They will try to intimidate you. But don't back off because you know the word. Jesus will say, again, it is written. Answer with the word. Can I have a big amen? In other words, when Jesus came there, he came fulfilling prophecies. When you come out there, come fulfilling the word. Can somebody say amen? Say, I am the fulfillment of the scriptures. Say, I am the fulfillment of the scriptures. And the amazing thing is, a moment of sadness is this, when you see Jesus come and he started weeping over Jerusalem because the people misunderstood why he came. He said, oh, Jerusalem. In other words, when people misunderstand you, it hurts. But what do? Don't give up on them. Finish your mission. I'm going to give you three things that will help you. Number one, have accurate knowledge. Number two, be audacious about the word. Number three, finish your course. Finish your assignment. In other words, when Jesus came there, the greater assignment was this. The assignment was he was coming as their Passover lamb. But this sacrifice was not a sacrifice that later on they have to do more. This was one sacrifice that will end every sacrifice. Can somebody say amen? His mission was complete success. So when he came there on that day and they were saying, Hosanna! Our Savior has come. Our Savior. He still saved them, but not the way they expected. Sometimes people want you to fight battles for them, but you give them the word and they can win through it. Amen. Can I have a big amen? Amen? In all the words, you come to me. You need help. Most people want me to pray for them. Is that correct? They want me to pray for them or give them the help I can. But this is how God operates. See, the reason why you have that problem is because you don't know about how the problem should be solved. Am I correct? So the problem is an ignorance problem. The solution is a wisdom solution. So you come to God, you pray, and what does God do? He will give you his word. When you do the word, the solution appears. How many of you understand that now? How many of you understand that now? See, because we think God will just do it. No. When you act on the word, he tells you, get up and walk. That's the word. When you act on that word, you're healed. How many of you understand that? Last night, actually earlier this morning, I was going through miracle pictures we haven't put anywhere on the internet. And I was just looking at those miracles. I was seeing this lady that had multiple sclerosis for so many years, been in a wheelchair. She used to be an athlete. And I was just looking at the picture, completely healed. And she was walking all over the place, completely healed. The wheelchair was just there. She walked all over the big building. We haven't put that online yet. And I'm going through all kinds of miracles. People that came with oxygen. I'm just going, wow. Thank God we believe the word. And all I can think about is the world needs to see that expressed through people. Can I have a big amen? Can I have a big amen? Today, I wanted to give you a different take on why Jesus came. He came to show you you. To show you your greatest potential. He came to show you how you really are. He came to show the Father, that's right. When he revealed the Father, then he says, he is your Father and he is my Father too. So like father, like child. How many of you understand that now? He came as a revelation of you. The revelation of Jesus which God gave to him, Revelations 1 verse 1. In other words, what am I saying to you today? Today, see yourself differently from how people have told you you are. Our biggest problem is self-concept. People look at you and say, well, I'm just using this example today. They look at you and say, well, you're like this, you're like that, you don't have this, you don't have that. Those things that you don't have, you're not responsible for. What you do have, you're responsible for. What do you have? You have the life of God in you. Can somebody say amen? You don't have to have a PhD in this. You can just be you and be better than a person with a PhD in that. In other words, you are so uniquely made. You're not a copy. You're a masterpiece. Can somebody say amen? So in other words, with all of your flaws, with all of your mistakes, you're still a masterpiece. In other words, stop beating yourself. Pick yourself back up. Look at the word of God and reign in life again. Say it's time to reign. Say it's time to reign. Now let me give the last piece. Say, it's time to untie the donkeys. Now, donkeys signifies anything or resources that God has already programmed for your success. How many of you can say amen to that? How many of you need finances? How many of you need a new car? Now, somebody said to me, well, why are you telling them about a car? Because they need it. They make it sound like God is not interested in you having a car. What? Yeah, I like Pastor Robert. Pastor Robert said he was interested in Jesus having a donkey. I like that one. Now, if God is concerned about you having a car, do you think your father doesn't care about whether you have a car or not? He does. You see, banish those kind of mindsets. Those are things that fight against your faith. Are you hearing me? How do you untie donkeys? Everybody say it's time to untie the donkeys. Number one, have an insight. Insight to know where those donkeys are. Can I have a big amen? Can I have a big amen? Have an insight. Number two, have a foresight. Are you catching this? Can I explain the first part? Know what that thing is. You've got to know where the donkey is. You've got to have an inside information about the donkey. Number two, you have to have a foresight. You've got to see it. What is the purpose of this donkey? What's the purpose of this resource? When there's a reason for the resource, it shows up for you. Because you want $1 million doesn't mean $1 million will show up. But write down the plan for $1 million and it would appear to you. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? See, nobody will give you $1 million if you don't have a plan for the million to appear. What are you going to do with $1 million? That's how we always do it. I will start writing. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. For $1 million, we'll break it down. For 10 million, we'll break it down. And that's how money starts coming, because it responds to purpose. The donkey, he didn't say, just untie the donkey for me. He said, because I have need of it. There's a purpose for that donkey. Can somebody say amen? Can somebody say amen? You've got to go beyond just, oh, I just want a donkey. No, why do you want it? If the why shows up, the how will appear. How do I get the donkey will happen after why I want to get a donkey. Why do, when I say to people, the TV trailer, that TV trailer is very expensive. Very expensive. The moment I said why we needed it, the how appeared. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? We had a red truck that was supposed to pull that. I said, oh, I just see a TV trailer, and in a short time we got it. And then I said, we need a red truck. I saw a big 250, you know, Ford F-250. Guess what? We got the truck. Vision, provision. How many of you understand that? For the vision. So you've got to give a reason for the donkey. Why do we need it? Don't just say, oh, because I'm poor. Yeah, there are a lot of poor people too. What separates you is why. Foresight. I know why I need it. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? And the next thing is boldness to speak it. If somebody asks you, what do you want? What would you say? Most people go like, Exactly. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? They have no picture of what they want. If you ask me, what can you do with 10 million? I'll tell you, I'll just list it for you now. Give me 100 million. I have my $100 million list. I have my $1 billion list. I have my 10 million. I have my 1 million. I have my 100,000. I have everything list. So that when the opportunity comes, I don't go, nothing. Promotion comes. Are you hearing me? You're prepared, opportunity shows up, you're promoted. But the problem is most people are never prepared. They are like this. There was a man, I tell the story and I'm done. This man, they've been believing God in the church for a million. And they've preached and preached and preached and preached, nothing happened. So they asked people, this is many years ago, they asked people, please, we need to donate this, nothing. So the night before he's preparing his message, and the Holy Ghost told him, don't prepare any message. Just write what you will do with 1 million. So he got up. The next day, he got up and they invited him to come and speak, the pastor. He gets up and starts speaking. He said, what can I do with 1 million? What can we do with 1 million? He began to lay out everything we can do. We can do this. We can do that. We can do this. We can do that. 1 million. We can do this. And as he's talking, the people are like, okay, okay, okay. At the end of the service, a man in the back walked up to him and said, sir, can I talk to you? He said, when I was in the back there and you started telling me what you could do with 1 million, God told me to give it to you. They got 1 million without sweat. Did you hear what I said? You will get it if you have a reason for it. People don't give to you because they smile. They give to you because there's purpose behind it. Are you hearing me? See, we go to people, oh, I'm so hungry. You know, that doesn't pull anything. But if you say there's purpose, we can build this and help the people. People will give into that. Can somebody say amen? Let vision come before provision. Can I have a big amen? Bow your heads. I'm going to pray for you. We're going to open your eyes of the Spirit. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for your seeds. I thank you for your people. I thank you for the greatness of your dreams in them. Thank you, Lord, that today, as you came into Jerusalem, they are coming into the Jerusalem. They are the ones that will save this generation. They are the saviors. Your word declares that saviors shall come out of Zion. Saviors shall come out of Zion, according to your word, Obadiah. You said, saviors shall come out of Zion. Father, these are your inheritance. You said, your word declares, as the Father sent you, so have you sent them. We declare that this is a week that will run with purpose. We thank you, Lord, even as we celebrate the passion that you have for us. Thank you, Lord. that we will run with a passion for the world around us. We'll run with a passion. Open their spiritual eyes to see. Open their eyes to see. Open their eyes to see. Open their eyes to see all of the resources available to them. And Father, I want to pray for those that have been struggling today. If you've been struggling, just stand up right now. If you've been struggling, going through a struggle, one thing or another, just stand up wherever you are. Stand up. God bless you. When Jesus comes, the tempter's power is broken. When Jesus comes, all tears are wiped away. He takes the gloom and fills your life with his glory. For all is changed when Jesus comes to stay. Sing one more time. When Jesus comes, yes, the tempter's power is broken. When Jesus comes, all tears are wiped away. He takes the gloom and fills your life with his glory. For all is changed when Jesus comes. For the Lord declares, for your shame I will give you glory. For your trials I will give you a testimony. For your pain you shall receive uncommon gain. For all that you've been going through, I declare to you, saith the Lord, that this has passed. The season of pain is over. And everything that concerns you, I'm aligning it again. God is healing hearts. He's healing your hurts. He's healing your past. He's healing those things that have been a struggle to you. Your finances are being healed. Your all the things that have been hovering over you. This week, I declare that this is the week that is resolved. I say it is resolved. I say it is resolved. This is a week of resolution. Everything that pertains you, go for it. Be audacious to ask big, and you shall receive. Be audacious to seek and you shall find. Be audacious to go and knock in the places you've been afraid of, and it shall be open to you. This is a week for audacity. I declare that you are winning this week. I say you're winning this week. I say you're winning this week. You are winning this week. I say you're winning this week. Come on, let's clap our hands and give him praise. Hallelujah. It is done. It is done. It is done. It is done. Amen. Tell a neighbor, it is done. Say the struggles are over. The Bible says, just cast your cares on him. He cares. And you're receiving wisdom now in Jesus' name. Are you excited? Come on, let's clap our hands and praise the Lord. Pastor Robert.
Amen. What we're going to do is we're going to collect our offerings and tithes today. Yes, you should clap. You should be happy. Amen. Can you give me a smile from where you are? Can you smile to me? There you go. See? Easy. Hallelujah. I want you to understand that God is doing more than what you are dreaming about. And the only thing we have to do, it's according action to what you hear. We're going to act according to what you are hearing. And I know that God has plans for our lives. We also have plans for this place and for many things and goals that we have to achieve this year. And for that, we need you to be in tune, faithful in the house of the Lord, so we can maintain this amazing building. Amen. And the more in unity we are, the better we're going to do, and better things are going to come to our lives. What that is going to do with you and me is that God is going to open the heavens in our behalf. What does that mean? That means that God is going to pour a favor in the midst of people with what you do. Anything that you do, you will see favor upon favor upon favor in your life. That's what God does. When you respond to His word, He responds to you according to how you believe in Him. So this morning I invite you to give accordingly. And let's all stand up today. If you need a write to check, you can write it to KEI. And if you don't have a check, but you have your plastic money, which is the same, Sister Athena is right there. And you can swipe your card and it works as well and the same as your cash. Amen. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for your word. We thank you for everything that you are doing in our lives. We thank you for new beginnings. We thank you for starting over. We thank you for this slingshot power that it goes back and it throws with force towards the goal that we have to do. Father, we are foreseeing things that come into us. We are announcing, we are receiving that this week and the rest of the month, it's already ours in Jesus' name. And I receive everything that you said today from you. I obtain it from you. I believe it and I will have it. Thank you for my car. Thank you for that beautiful and amazing black car that I'm going to go and pick that up today. It is for free. I'm not going to have to pay anything. It's mine. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. I will tell you about it next week. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So if you need a car, you have to say thank you, Jesus, for the car. Amen. So come forward and give your offerings and tithes. And after this, we are officially dismissed. Say hello to somebody. Love somebody. Come and give your offering. Amen.